I feel like I'm back on the radio. For those of you who don't know, Sean and I do a daily Bible question and answer program called A Reason for Hope, and we really get a kick out of exploring your questions on God's Word. And so if we raise more questions, we give you answers here tonight, you've got that great feedback loop right there in place, so you can dig deeper into the Word.
And the added benefit is you only see us from the waist up.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Well, Hebrews chapter 13 is where we are tonight, the final chapter in the book of Hebrews. And, you know, one of the wonderful things that we discover when we go through a book like this is that there's a real pattern, especially to the letters of Paul. Many people believe that Paul was the writer of Hebrews. There's a lot of debate about all of that. Probably the best call on who the actual author is like Origen said, only God knows who wrote Hebrews. But certainly God was the one who inspired the writing of the book of Hebrews. And like the letters that we see in the New Testament, boy, Hebrews has given us an awful lot of spiritual steak to chew on. An awful lot of profound statements about what it means to really know God in a deep and an abiding way. What all of these wonderful threads in God's tapestry of painting Messiah in the Old Testament were all about. But like these letters, we come to the end of these letters, and we always get the so what. You know, granted, you know, we've gone from pillar to post. We've talked about the meaning of the sacrifices. We've talked about why there was a Levitical priesthood, why there needed to be a better priesthood. Shoot, we've even dipped our toe in the water about that mysterious man, Melchizedek, who comes on the scene and is this beautiful picture of the eternal priesthood that Jesus has that wasn't just limited to one of the tribes of Israel. But we've gone through all of this. And now in chapter 13, we see how God wants to apply these truths to our lives. The so what, if you will, of all of these marvelous truths that we've explored. So before we go any further and we get into that so what, would you pray for us tonight and ask the Lord to guide us into truth, Sean?
Happy to. Dad, thank you that we have the chance to gather together like this, exercising a freedom we by no means take for granted. We want to ask that we would make the most of this time, not only centered on you, but receptive to your word, sensitive to your heart, and ultimately eager to see how you use this word to not only edify and exhort, but encourage us in our own lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, as we launch into Hebrews 13, it's always good to know where we've come from. Could you give us a little bit of a catching up to speed about where we've been in Hebrews 12?
Sure. Continuing on with the author of Hebrews' points that have essentially been building up everything we need to know about Jesus before we do something with it, he closes on an interesting note in noting that God, among everything that we know about him, we can call him a loving father, we can call him a just judge, but interestingly enough, the two words that conclude the chapter leading into this one are consuming fire.
Wow.
Not generally the terms we like to describe God as, unless you like the Prince of Egypt, but the emphasis and point was this reference over and over again in the Old Testament. You see it in Moses, you see it in Isaiah, you see it throughout the Old Testament, and even going as far as the book of Revelation, this emphasis on God being the sort of thing that tests you down to your core. And if you aren't made of the same thing or you aren't just like him, you crumble. But if you are a part of him, you only get better. And Paul has made this point in 1 Corinthians that the judgment we'll experience, even as Christians, will be tried like fire. The things that aren't of God will be burned up. The things that are of God will be made more glorious. And he continues on with this point in noting that even in the face of persecution, we know that our God is a consuming fire, that he's not only able to strengthen us in the midst of this, but is perfecting us through that. So with then that perfection in mind, that picture of us being more fire-like rather than not fire-like, we continue on with what that looks like.
Yeah, some real practical insight into how we can be the kind of people that live lives that when it's all said and done and our lives are exposed to that fiery consuming presence of God, we're going to have something left over, something that actually survives this life and is going to be something that is going to bless us for all eternity. In chapter 13, I saw one interesting outline of it, is that it can be broken down into seven different practical insights into what arguably is the one thing that will last forever that we can take with us out of this world. It's love. It's God's love. When we receive God's love, when we relate God's love, we're operating in an eternally significant way in this world. In fact, if you devote yourself, you make your priority in this life anything else or anything less than receiving and relating God's love, chances are you're not going to have a whole lot to show for this life when it's all said and done. And so we launch with this interesting statement, let brotherly love continue. Wow. We just spent an awful lot of time parked right there, couldn't we?
Yeah, we even have a state named after that in the Greek, don't we?
Yeah, again, brotherly love is the term Philadelphia.
Which is a combination in terms of the word phileo. Now, in Greek, for those of you who've read C.S. Lewis's The Four Loves, highly recommended, by the way, to just map out what it means to love like a Christian. The four loves that are most commonly used in the New Testament in particular are storge, or affection, doing nice things for people. There's eros, from the term erotic, which isn't necessarily bad. It's referring to attraction, that familial or relational love, in the sense of husband and wife in particular. Phileo, which is admiration, or the kind of friendship love that is shared even between people who aren't familially related, but also include that. And then finally, agape, or agape, which includes all three of the former, but in a unique way. God's love is how Paul defines it in 1 Corinthians 13 and verse 4. But when we're talking about Philadelphia, or phileo, in this sense, we're recognizing that third option, the respect or the admiration between people that you would commonly find most appropriate in a family. For example, in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 1 through 2, we get a good outline of this with men and women, young and old. I think that covers about everybody.
Yeah.
And he says, do not rebuke an older man, but exhort him as a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, and younger women as sisters with all purity. And this emphasis on familial terms is important because it's centered around the idea of why Christians call each other brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so. We're not trying to be Roman Catholic. We're saying that we share the same Father. And that's, of course, in a spiritual sense, because while we don't necessarily share the same Father, there's a direct opposition to that biologically. There is, in fact, a commonality in which I also call you my father and brother, because we both relate to the same
right.
Father as Lord. What's also important as well is the love that was commanded by Jesus was not only modeled in the nature of God itself, but kind of assumed to be the way that we treat each other going forward. If God is, in fact, the one we're called to model, and he loved us on the basis of, well, not our behavior, because then he'd judge us, not the way we talk to him, because he'd condemn us, but on the basis of, my Father sent me to redeem you, and that's it, then how should we be treating each other? The idea of how you talk, how you act, not always the best. But I do know that we share one thing in common, and it's on that basis that I value you. And also note, the author of Hebrews says, is on the same basis we should continue to treat each other.
Yeah, and that assumption there, let brotherly love continue. In other words, it's assumed that this is how things are in the body of Christ. Now, personally, your mileage may vary, but for some of us, that's a pretty big assumption, because if you're like me, maybe you've gone to churches and it seems to be a competition to see who can win the first out of the parking lot after the service. Maybe it's a situation where you found that people were kind of cliquey, in a sense. They hung out with the people that they knew, that they were comfortable with, but if you're new and you're not a part of things, well, not so much. You know, are you guys familiar with the concept of a secret shopper? you know, where they send somebody into a grocery store or a restaurant, and they work for the company, but they just present themselves like they were a regular customer, and then they're able to give an evaluation. Well, when Pam and I travel, we like to go to churches, and sometimes I like to play secret shopper, you know, especially if it's a Calvary Chapel I've never been to before. And what I'll do is, you know, I'll just come on in and, you know, kind of sit there, maybe in the back, you know, the choice seats after all, and just kind of wait to see, you know, how people relate to a complete stranger in their midst. You know, is there that sense of being part of the family of God wherever you go? Well, I got to say, sometimes my results are really mixed. Sometimes you will go to a place and there's people that are really concerned about you. They care about you. They're invested and they're involved with your life. If you're new, they want to get to know you. They want to find out what's going on with you. You know, they just love fellowshipping with one another, this brotherly love, this part of the family of God. You know, I remember when I first became a Christian, this concept of brotherly love was so new and so strange to me, because a lot of the relationships that I was involved with were all competition-based. It was all trying to stay ahead and not do something stupid, and, you know, it was like, you know, not wanting to show weakness in the wolf pack. And then suddenly, you know, here I was, a Christian, and I found out that there were these people that looked at me as a part of their family, and I was just so hungry for fellowship. I remember riding my bike like 5 miles to hang out with a friend just so that we could like read the word together and all of this stuff. And we had this love of Jesus that's in common. You know, the assumption here that the writer of Hebrews is making is, if you're part of that forever family that you described, Sean, you know, if you love the Father, you're going to love his kids. And that is the basis for all that. We don't love one another because people have been lovely to us. We don't love one another because, you know, it's an obligation, but because you've got God as your Father and I've got God as my Father. There's that bonding that goes on there. And it's that beautiful brotherly love. Now, it's something that we got to grow into. It's not something that happens to us natively or naturally. And maybe that's why a lot of churches, you don't see a lot of it, because a lot of people will say, well, you know, I'm here, I'm part of this, you know, organization, I pay my tithes, I take notes, and so on. But they don't realize that what God is really up to among his people is he wants to serve his love family style among the people who gather there. And so we should always be asking ourselves this question: how are we doing as far as learning to love other people? How are we doing as far as learning to get out of our comfort zones and extend ourselves to others? Are we the kind of people, for instance, if we see somebody sitting by themselves and somebody, you know, you don't know their name or whatever, do you take the initiative to go up to that person and say, you know, hey, you know, I've never met you before, you know, I'm so and so, you know, what brought you here, you know? Is there something I can pray for you about? Boy, it sounds so simple, but it's not so simple in terms of our experience. The writer of Hebrews just assumes that this is the case. Let brotherly love continue. Now, notice he doesn't post high up to agape. Let agape love continue. Man, all you guys just, you know, unconditionally love one another. He talks about phileo love, that family love. You know, in a sense, he gives us something that we can shoot for, but we need to be shooting for it because it doesn't happen natively or naturally. Churches, generally speaking, like everything else in this world, will tend to run towards coldness unless we do something about turning on the heat and the warmth. And so I would really exhort you, you know, as far as the first pillar of the so what of Hebrews, letting brotherly love continue. Ask yourself this question: am I growing in brotherly love? Am I using the opportunity that we have to gather together to share that brotherly love? and not waiting for other people to go first. You know, like I said, that secret shopper thing where I sit there and I just act like I'm a stranger to see if people are going to be friendly. Well, the ones where they're not friendly, finally I can't stand it anymore. And I'll go, hey, you know, I'm Scott. I'm from Tucson and all this. And, oh, you know, it's great to be with you guys and all of this. I just can't hold that in. Ask God to give you that same kind of heart wherever you are as far as coming to church with the idea of not leaving this place without encouraging one other person. Praying for one other person, getting to know one other person before you leave. So, you know, again, let brotherly love continue. And there's another kind of love that follows in verse 2.
Yes, indeed. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by doing so, some have unwittingly entertained angels. Now, here's a rabbit trail we can dive into. It's a fun one because this is a demonstration not just of familial love, but of hospitality. And hospitality comes from the word love towards strangers.
Yes.
And a stranger, for those of you who don't know, is someone you don't know. But the idea behind that is you really don't know who you're dealing with when you show hospitality. So in a sense, be caught with your pants up in this case. Get caught doing the right thing, because with that incentive in mind of everything and everyone I interact with in this life will be played back to me, in a sense, on Judgment Day, that I will give an account for the way that I treated people, whether I knew them or not. And in the ancient world, usually determined someone's value on the basis of one of three things, all of which are very superficial and still common today. First is where they're from, is if they're a local or they're a part of the tribe, so to speak, they can share that common origin with you. Romans greet other Romans, that sort of mindset. Greeks greet other Greeks. But if, on the other hand, you were a Scythian, or in just the most general term possible, a barbarian, someone who didn't speak Greek, that term is associated with someone you'd want to avoid, not just because they'd, you know, club your wife by the hair and drag her off. It was the idea that they weren't of our special buddy club.
Right.
You don't give them that hospitality because they're a stranger. And as we remember from those Michael Jackson music videos, stranger danger.
Yeah.
But continuing on as well, it's not just the idea of they're not where you're from. It's also the idea of, okay, Romans greet Romans. What about people that have a common goal? Well, that's kind of hard to determine if you don't know somebody, and that gap also causes some distance between people. And then, of course, there's those that are just actively opposed to you. We remember the parable of the Good Samaritan, those who were on a national level, a social level, and a spiritual level in conflict with us. You know, the idea of someone who's in fundamental conflict, even with your core values, you don't want to treat them well, because that expresses an approval, in a sense, of what they're doing. But in Christianity, it essentially flipped this stereotype on its head and introduced the concept of what we call hospitals, not just in a direct medical sense, but people who would open their homes to others on the basis of, this is a place for the stranger. And why? It comes from a word, intrinsic value. Now, we think that that's just common sense today, but it was actually a radical idea in the ancient world. And one of the things that we actually need to point out to people is how Christianity has impacted world culture. The assumption that you would care for people you don't know, because that was a new thing. And what's important to note about that is...
Hence, like a hospital, you know, not just for people that know the staff at the hospital, but taking in anyone and everyone who had a need.
And that was the point of emphasis. Orphanages is the same idea, but the motivation for this came from two directions. The first is kind of in between the text, the intrinsic value, or value based on your nature. Intrinsic meaning that, pertaining to one's nature. And what was neat about this whole deal is that instead of recognizing someone on the basis of their nationality or on the basis of their values or even of their own affiliation, them not wanting to kill you at the moment, for example, the reason Christians would value somebody and open these hospitables by name as open to the stranger was because of a common, reference the previous point, creator. that in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26, our value is determined because we're all made in the image and likeness of God. Now, if you want to know more about that, our radio program, we address this in a bit more detail. But what's key about this is that a common creator, a common father, equal treatment in wanting to treat them well. Because on top of us wanting to love each other by nature, there was also the possibility that you don't know who exactly you're ministering to, which brings us to what the author of Hebrews said directly, not just in their value, but in their unknown identity, because some, not all, but some have unwittingly entertained angels. Now, what does that seem like?
Well, it's really created kind of a stir in an uproar sometimes in Christian circles. It was back in the 80s when I was in youth ministry, but there was sort of one of those winds of doctrine, kind of a fad that blew through the church about angels. I think it started when a pop singer named Amy Grant had a hit, Angels Watching Over Me. And, you know, people got all hopped up about that, and people wrote books. Billy Graham had one called Angels, God's Secret Agents, and, you know, how there's angels on assignments. And as this kind of caught fire and got traction among God's people, people started having all these angel stories about meeting angels. The Vanishing Hitchhiker. You ever heard that story before? When I wrote my book, Reasonable Doubts, we talked about urban myths and legends. And the Vanishing Hitchhiker is an urban legend. It is told in a lot of different variations and stories, but it all kind of goes like this. A person picks up a hitchhiker, and the hitchhiker and this person get involved with a conversation. And before too long, the hitchhiker, when he's getting out of the car, or you know, a little later down the line, says something about, well, you really need to know that Jesus is coming back very, very soon. And then the person turns around to say something, and they're gone. Now, I've heard people share that, and they say, you know, this is my testimony. I must have met an angel because this person was right there, and then they vanished. Well, the problem with that, and the reason it kind of gets characterized as an urban legend, is, believe it or not, there's all kinds of variations on that theme, and they all kind of have the same components, except it's based upon what culture you're dealing with. There are those who will use that same Vanishing Hitchhiker tale and say, oh yeah, I picked up this hitchhiker, and this hitchhiker said, you know, to me, oh, you really need to read the Book of Mormon, and then they vanish. You know, or, oh, you know, you really need to read the Quran, and then they vanish. And, you know, and that's why we say it's an urban legend, because the same basic components of this story get told over and over again. And a lot of people were like, oh, you know, do you think you have an angel? You know, do you have a guardian angel that's looking out for you? And, you know, there are bumper stickers, never drive faster than your angel can fly. And you know, the problem with this is we can go to one of two extremes when it comes to angels. If you've been with us in our study in Hebrews, we are told in Hebrews chapter 1 that Jesus is greater than the angels. But angels are defined in a really interesting way. The writer of Hebrews says, are they not ministering spirits set out to aid those who will inherit salvation? So, you know, there are some people that hear about the Vanishing Hitchhiker and, you know, the variations on it. Oh, you know, it's just a bunch of hooey and overheated imagination. But the Bible does say that God does have these angels on assignment. That they are here to help those of us who will inherit salvation. So we don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. However, we don't want to become so obsessed with angels that they become our focus. Can you think of a place in the Word of God where angels are actually embarrassed when they become the focus?
Twice in the same book, in the book of Revelation chapter 19 and again in chapter 21, the Apostle John, being shown this vision of the new heavens and the new earth, he bows down to the angel that is showing him these things, and he says, see that you do not do that.
Right.
I am of your fellow servants of those who are ministers of Jesus. Worship God, for the spirit of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. I'm literally, that's what the word angel means, a messenger here. Don't praise the messenger. I didn't make the product. I'm just delivering it.
Yeah, exactly. And so, you know, there are some people that become so consumed with angels. It even got so bad at one point in the 80s that people started praying to their angel and talking to their angel. And, oh, you know, you could just see the angels going, oi, I can't believe this. But the other side of it is to ignore the presence of angels working among God's people, because they do, and they show up in ways that we probably wouldn't recognize, correct?
No, and especially when they weren't being looked for. In fact, in Genesis chapter 18, Abraham was kind of caught off guard when he was given that interesting timetable for the birth of his first legitimate son, Isaac. The Lord came in the company of two angels who he sent ahead to warn Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, what was interesting about the angels and the Lord being distinguished from among them is that they just look like men. But then when Abraham had them sit down for a meal, he didn't have enough time to get the loaves ready, so it was just unleavened, set the tone for later on.
Yep.
He sat down and recognized that the moment they started talking about, hey, where's your wife? She's not for sale, if that's what you're asking.
Yeah,
says, no, she's going to have a baby next year. Wait a minute, I know you. The conversation was much pleasant from that point onward. But the one directly identified as the Lord and the other two identified as angels, we see this trend in the Old and New Testament. When, say, for example, Joseph was warned by an angel in a dream saying, get out of here because Herod's already nuts, but he's going to act on it now. Or the angel that told Joseph, hey, this isn't an angel visited me story. This is legitimate. This is the Holy Spirit.
Right, or the angel that intervened and allowed Simon Peter to walk out of prison. In fact, slapped him upside the head pretty good to get him moving.
Yeah, right? He gave him a hockey check. Anyway, that was entertaining. But we're noting that point is that angels tend to do their best work when they're not the center of attention. Because if an angel does come to you and he wants you to focus on him, characteristically, it's probably not an angel,
yeah.
Or at least it is categorically, but not the kind you want talking to you.
Yeah, and notice the key statement here, and I think this can save us a peck of trouble and keep the whole concept of angels and how they're involved with our lives in a proper place. It says, don't forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some have unwittingly entertained angels. In other words, we're probably not going to understand how many times angels have been involved with our lives, how many conversations you may have had with an actual angelic being in your life until you see the heavenly replay of your life. Because like a secret agent, and I love that name of Billy's book on the subject, they do their best work when they don't draw attention to themselves, when they don't make themselves the center of the focus that is going on here. You know, in other words, if you have an encounter with an angel, I don't know how many of you remember that that program, Touched by an Angel, you know, and it had kind of the same plot thing, you know, where the angels were supposed to help somebody out, and, you know, they're in this big crisis. And then at the end, they had the big reveal where Roma Downey would suddenly glow behind her and say, we're angels, and everybody's like, oh, wow, it's an angel, and all of a sudden. You're not going to have the big reveal. I don't think.
Just an aside note as well, you don't become an angel. That's Mormonism.
Yeah, and Michael Landon, kind of highway to heaven, you know, trying to earn his angel's wings, and again, you know,
it's a wonderful life.
It's a wonderful life. Every time a bell rings, an angel gets his wings. No, that's not how it works. In fact, I think there's only one example of any kind of angelic being with wings, and it was kind of a demonic sort of a thing. But, you know, I mean, we do see cherubim that have six wings that fly. But
and seraphim, if you would consider them separate. But no, when I say, for example, Gabriel identified directly as an angel, announced her pregnancy to her. She wasn't wondering, why do you have the extra appendages? He looked just like a man.
Yeah, and I guess what I would say to you is this. First of all, if you need angelic intervention in this life to accomplish God's will in your life, you've got it. God's not short on angels. You know, the other side of it is, you know, I see Christians get so involved with fallen angels that I've been in churches and prayer meetings where they spend more time talking to Satan than they do to God. And, you know, there's this demonic entity and there's this principality and these sort of things. You know, the bottom line is this. We're told in Revelation chapter 12 that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, spiritual forces of wickedness in heavenly places, and so
Ephesians
on.
Ephesians 6, yeah.
You know, we do have an opposition in our walk with God, and it is fallen angelic in nature, and they're no one to be trifled with. You know, the other myth about angels is, you know, they're the kind of the fat babies with the trumpets that are floating by on cloud. They're awesome creatures. I mean, if an angel was here and just said, oh, well, Scott, I'm going to help you with an illustration here. I'm going to reveal who I really am. We'd probably all pass out from fright.
Even those who knew what was going on.
Yeah. So they're no one to be trifled with. But as far as worrying about fallen angels, don't worry about fallen angels. Because two things. Number one, Revelation chapter 12 says that when Satan fell, he took a third of the stars of heaven with him, the stars of heaven being a euphemism for angels. A third of the angels fell with Satan. Oh, a third of the angels fell. But what does that mean mathematically? It means two-thirds didn't. It means God's got Satan outgunned 2-1 just on angels, right? And the other thing is 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4 says, you are of God, little children, you've overcome them. For greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You know, read the encounters that Jesus had with demons in his earthly ministry. Never once did they say, well, put up your dukes. Let's see how this is all going to... No, they were terrified of him. There wasn't a struggle. There wasn't a battle. It was over before it started. They're like, just don't send us to the abyss, please, sir. Send us to the pigs instead. The Jesus who dwells in you through the Spirit absolutely terrifies the wicked one. So don't fall into the idea. First of all, Christians can never be victims of demon possession. God is the one who indwells you. The scripture doesn't say, greater is he that is in you than he that is in you. If you have some habitual sin in your life, it's not because the devil made you do it. It's because you're doing it. You know, you need to put to death the deeds of the flesh, the scripture says. And God will give you the power of the Holy Spirit to do that. But, you know, when we see spiritual warfare going on and we do know, we don't want to underestimate the presence of angels, what they do in this world. We don't want to overestimate it. But understand this. If you need angelic intervention to get God's will done, you're going to get it. If you need, for instance, for an angel to do the Roma Downey big reveal and let you know that you've really got an angel going on there, if you need that, you've got it, because God is the giver of every good and perfect gift. Now, if you don't have that, you don't need it. So trust God with all of that. You've got his word. You've got his indwelling Holy Spirit. You've got the body of Christ to support you. Pretty decent resources there. So, you know, don't forget to entertain angels for doing
strangers.
So. Entertain strangers for doing so. Some have unwittingly entertained angels. I am really looking forward personally to the heavenly replay of my life, because whoever it was who said there's more to life than meets the eye, I think Neil Young sang that song. But the bottom line, nothing could be more truthful for us as believers. More is going on around us all the time. This physical that we perceive with our five senses is just the tip of the iceberg of what's going on in this reality. The vast majority is spiritual in nature, and God's got it handled. So, you know, the exhortation there is don't blow strangers off. And by the way, there was a movement in the church at that time where they were blowing strangers off. And you know, there's another interesting take on this. Some have said that the idea of angels there, all the word angel means is what?
Messenger.
And so what could be talking about here is the idea of those who were traveling, who were teaching the gospel, actual regular human beings and so forth, Would stay at a particular place. They'd extend hospitality to them. They would teach. But there were those that were exploiting that, and false teachers were fleecing the flock and so forth. There's a really interesting quote from a book that was written about 80, 90 AD called the Didache. It was the, Calvary basics, if you will, of their day. You know, if you wanted to know how the church ran things, it had this kind of input from it. It's not divinely inspired, but this is the way the early church ran things. It said, "Let every apostle that comes to you be received as the Lord, but he shall not remain except one day. But if there be need, also the next. And if he remains 3 days, he's a false prophet." "And when the apostle goes away, let him take nothing but bread. If he asks for money, he's a false prophet. And every prophet that speaks in the Spirit, you shall neither try nor judge, for every sin shall be forgiven, but this one sin shall not be forgiven. But not everyone that speaks in the Spirit is a prophet, but only if he holds to the ways of the Lord. Therefore, from their ways shall the false prophet and the true prophet be known." So, these traveling apostles, if you will, that would come into these different towns, they were a little leery of them. Because, once bitten, twice shy. You know, there were individuals that say, "Oh, yeah, I've got a new revelation from God for you." And, it turns out to be false doctrine. In fact, in 3 John, there was a huge conflict between two main people in the church, one by the name of Diotrephes, who said, "By no means should you ever entertain any kind of traveling missionary." He is not content. We're told about this Diotrephes guy. He's not content with that, putting down the Apostle John. He himself does not receive the brethren and forbids those who wish to, putting them out of the church. In other words, this Diotrephes guy probably got burned in a situation with one of these traveling teachers, reacted against it, and just said, "Nobody in the church is going to entertain any of these people." Well, we are told that we are not to imitate what is evil, but what is good. He who does good is of God. He who does evil has not seen God. Demetrius has a good testimony from all and from the truth itself. We bear witness, our witness is true. In other words, Demetrius is going, whoa, you're taking this way too far. So, when we see in Hebrews the idea of, be sure to entertain angels, you may be entertaining a genuine apostle. That is a definite way we could take that sort of thing. The bottom line is, don't be afraid to extend yourself to strangers. So,
and then finishing up in verse 3, and definitely relevant to our day and age right now, "Remember the prisoners as if chained with them, those who are mistreated, since you yourselves are in the body also." The author of Hebrews using the same point that Paul the Apostle made in 1 Corinthians, noting the bodies of many members. If one is exalted, all are exalted. If one suffers, all are suffering. And the emphasis is just on this. There are two kinds of Christians, those who are and those who will be persecuted. If we put ourselves in the shoes, literally and figuratively, of those who are suffering for the same things that we ought to be doing, well, there should be some empathy there. And just as a homework assignment, we recommend you read 1 Peter chapter 4, 12 through 16, and John 15, verses 18 through 20. Jesus said, hey, people are going to hate you, not because of you, hopefully, but because you're acting like me. I acted like me, and they hated me. So what do you think is going to happen to you?
Right.
But the point being made is just that. If we're going to be a consistent example of Jesus and treated the way he was, that's not always going to be pretty. So wrapping up this study and just noting the points, we can summarize all 3 of these verses with 3 as-if scenarios. Treat not only those in the church as if they were family.
Because they are.
Yep. And also note, treat strangers as if they were angels, because they might be.
Could be, yeah.
And also, treat those who are being persecuted as if they were you, because someday they will be.
Yeah. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 12 says that all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. So if you think that's just a problem over in Afghanistan right now, and it will never come knocking on your door, you're not paying attention to current events. As Bob Dylan once famously said, you don't have to be a weatherman to know which way the wind's blowing. You know, the era of the comfortable Christian in our culture may very well be a thing of the past sooner than any of us realize. Are you ready for that? You know, and one of the ways to get ready for that is to have empathy for those who are suffering right now. We're going to have the worship team come on up and finish with a final song. But after that song, I'd like you guys to do something a little different tonight. Many of you are aware, most of us are aware, of the awful things going on in Afghanistan right now, and gotten some input regarding the church in Afghanistan right now. Bible-believing Christians just like you and me that are number one on the Taliban hit list right now. They are in very, very difficult circumstances. Literally, they're going to have to lay their lives on the line as believers, because during the American involvement, they kind of came out of the shadows. They were, you know, again, made known there's been some really terrible intelligence breakdowns that have allowed the Taliban to be able to identify individuals with connections to the West, or even individuals that were believers in Christ. And so a lot of these believers in the Lord, just like you and me, are hunted individuals right now. When the scripture tells us here in Hebrews chapter 3, remember the prisoners as if chained with them, those who are mistreated, since you yourself are in the same body also. What I'd like you all to do before we leave tonight, after the final song, get together with one or a couple other people, and I'd just like you not to spend 20 minutes, but just a couple of minutes praying for our brothers and sisters in Afghanistan tonight before we leave. You know, there is more that is accomplished through prayer than any of us could ever dream of. And who knows, in response to those prayers, maybe we will hear stories of really powerful intervention of the Lord, maybe even angelic intervention that will keep our beloved brothers and sisters in Afghanistan alive, allow them to be a testimony to those that are living in the darkness and false teaching of Islam. Very sincere individuals, but sincerely wrong. Let's seize this opportunity before we hit the road to spend a little time before the Lord praying tonight.